there's another paper which we're currently writing up with Imad Al-Khalil and Andy Punk. And I don't have time to talk about it, but I talked about this at Princeton University about 3 weeks ago or something like this. You can actually get a hot dog from some of these farm categories. And the hot dog that you get, for instance, for the subjection one, up to Swiss is the one for gunshot type for multi-zeta value. So simple subjection algebra that gives you a hot algebra. And that hot algebra is basically the hot algebra that works because that tells you that every superficial object has this hot algebra structure. Thank you. Alright. So one question is, there's always a sort of mystery to me how Gerson Hammer got his bracket. Or how you get this, you can write it down. So now if you're an opera, you just may see that, but there's a free bracket. Where does it come from? And is there some way of general nonsense that I can just produce this? And the answer is yes. And the answer is co-completion. So let me just go through this slide and then I'll tell you what that means. So this is just a similar thing that you can take colimits. And it is denoted again by something strange. It has the monodic product called the Bay convolution. So I get a new monodic category. So this is a good thing to try to build a fine category. Now I do one thing. I take one element, so I'll build a fine category again with a trivial z. And I take the colimit over z of my inclusion function I. The j is just that I go to the colimit. Right? And then there's a theorem which says that if I take the symmetric monodic category subcategory generated by I in this co-completion, that's a finite category. This is complete general nonsense. Actually, that theorem is not easy to prove. But let's see what this does for us. So I said for optimized I, example, it's the one where the morphisms are trees. Right? Maybe I should make it with a tree picture. So this is for instance, yeah, so that's a tree. So if I take a root here, then so for optimized, so this little guy doesn't exist. But there's a morphism like this, and say here was a root, and here was a root, and then the root may be here, and this is a tree, so the morphism is given by a tree. So I take a functor, and then, what is Om? So, then I just say, when I have this star, I number the flags 1 to n, and I apply my functor to it, this should be an object, and this object I'll just call Om. That's the n part of the operand. And now, what does the co-completion do? So what is O hat of I? So if I go through co-complete categories, say vector spaces, what is it? It's the sum of the Om as n covariant. That's what it is. And now you can ask, so this is what the functor would do on this I. And now you can ask, well, in this co-completion, what are the morphisms? And you compute them. You can just sit down with a 2-I computation. And you find that the morphisms are just given by this. The classes are sum of circ I's. That's the only morphism, more or less. Right? You have to say how many inputs and how many outputs, but that's the only morphism. And there you go. That's the 3D structure. So it just popped out. I took the colimit, and I found out the universal operation, the only one that is in there, is the circ product, which is the 3D structure. And I get by taking any commutator, I get a Lie bracket. And there's something the SN shouldn't be here. So it lifts, so actually what Gerson Hammer did was he worked in the non-sigma case and then you don't take covariance. But this is kind of, we can get that back by lifting it. So actually it's canonical when you're taking a symmetric setup. So here's a lift, just to say that this works. You can go through the list and just start computing. And this pops out the structures you're looking for. If you start with operad, you get, so these are the root of trees, and you get the 3D operad. Remember this was a final category with trivial z, and that was an operad. So you get the 3D operad. If you start with odd operad, which means that you have root of trees that are oriented on orientation of the set of edges, you get odd 3D. So if you just take planar, you would get all operations. That's kind of boring. If you take an operand with modification, so this is exactly the setup for Gerson-Hammer, for the Deninus convection on the ultra cohomology. When you do the computation, you get the final category, so you get the operand of black and white root of trees, and you see that you get 3D plus modification, which is exactly what you need to get this Gerson-Hammer. If you have cyclic, then it's weird cyclic, you don't get anything good, you just get some weird commutative modification. But if you take odd cyclic, which is you put an orientation on the set of edges, you enumerate the edges, and if you flip the edges, you get a minus sign. If you do that, you get a Lie bracket, actually an odd Lie bracket. And this is something that, so this is one of the things that we're going to cover with the Lie. And there's no free Lie structure, it's just a Lie bracket. Again, you can compute it. You just compute what is the universal operation in there, it's an odd Lie bracket. And so if you can sort of self-learning, you get odd DGD, and if you allow disconnected, so NC means non-connected, so if you allow disconnected graph, you actually get DD. So this is really nice.
What
kind of DD? What
kind of DD?
Last slide. Last slide. And so you can see this is just, it came from nothing. It's something from nothing. It's just a colimit. And you can really get exactly the operations you want. And it's not surprising anymore, they're calculable. Okay, so here's something I put in for the synthetic people. So, continue to try these three geometries, commutative Lie and associative geometries. And how do you get something like this? So I said if you have this odd, if you have an odd cyclic operand somewhere, odd cyclic operand, you get this odd Lie bracket. How do you get an odd cyclic operand? So for synthetic people, you start out with a synthetic vector space Lie. And you look at the endomorphism operand from D to D. And you have this dualization. That the dualization has degree 1. So you figure out that that's actually an odd cyclic operat. And now there's a trick. If you take an odd cyclic operat and tense it with a cyclic operat, you get in, this is the bracket around. So the bracket around these should be here. So it's the formula should be O-N, sorry, O tensor P-N. You just take the naive tensor product, this is O-N tensor P-N. Then if one of the guys is arthritic, and the other one is cyclic. The episodic is arthritic. It's the same odd tensor, odd even, and so on and so on. So you do it for yourself, cyclic operands, commonly, and you get the algebra. But that's exactly on this coefficient, on the sum of the SN invariants. That's where the algebra is. And if you have a sequence of vector spaces, you can take the limit, and then you get the algebra that Conservator is looking at. So that's kind of nice. So that's an application. That's where you find these things. And we can do this quite in general. It's not just this list. You took the pains to write down when you can actually do sort of something odd, then odd makes sense. You have to do a presentation and so on. So if you want, I can discuss that. So odd, so if you have that, odd basically means that you have orientation on the edges. And if you flip the edges, you get a cultural sign. All right? Then, yeah, I'd say that's 5 minutes late, so I mean, I'll say this. So the next type of operation, the first operation you can do is bar and cobalt. So this comes from algebra. So say you have an associative algebra, you might want a free resolution of this algebra. How are you going to get one? So there's a standard trick. So what you can do is, it's kind of weird. So what you can do is, you can take, first of all, you can make your algebra into a, sorry, you can take it, I did the other way around, but you can take your algebra and make it into a free co-algebra. So just a tensor algebra with plucking apart. Then if I have a co-algebra, I can make a free algebra, it's just a tensor algebra, and then tensoring together. That actually works. You have to put in time. You have to shift it once, otherwise it doesn't work. And then if I do this back and forth, so I take my algebra, bar it, then it's a co-algebra, then I co-bar it, it's an algebra again. But this is a DG algebra now because I have differentials. I could have said it was a DG algebra, and that's a free resolution, that's a theorem. Okay? And I add algebra as a trivial example of what I was doing. So you can ask the question, well, now can I do this for a finite category? And the answer is yes. As soon as I have this nice presentation where I sort of know what odd means, I can do it. We can do product and bar transforms, we can do co-bar transforms, we can do W construction. So this means the model category structure. But this is very powerful. That means that if you have some theory and you're asking, well, you know, what are the relations, and now what are the presentation, what's the resolution of these relations, you can just do it. So if you want to resolve proper, I'd say, plug it in, it's there. Okay, this is just like an algebra resolution, so you have three resolutions of these relations. The one that I like is the Simon transform, so that's kind of weird. So that's usually Kapanis for Mike, but this was invented by Kessler and Kapanis for modular operands, and by Ginsberg and Kapanis for operands. If you have another reality, then you can do it sort of in one step, right? Because what you can do is you can do it like the algebra, and then you get a co-algebra, and it just can co-bar it. Okay? And that's called the Simon transform. And this is the one that's relevant for physics and math, right? Okay? And that I can do. So what happens with the Simon transform is this. So if I start Simon transforming an operand, then actually the algebraic structure of an algebra of this Simon transform will be R for E. And the Simon transform, you only have a sort of a free gadget, right? And you have a differential. So if I look at algebras over a free gadget, that's easy, because it's free. And all you need is to give the object, that's it. But if I have a quasi free, that means it's free of an algebra, but not a free differential. So the differential will give you one equation, only one equation. And that equation is the master equation. And that was back in physics. And the last slide will have. So that slide will have sort of the master equation. So what kind of stuff do we get? So the structure here will be R for E, and the master equation is exactly as this for E. So if I start with a cyclic operand, I'll get R E, and I get this equation, which you might recognize as an R Kapon equation. That's the abstraction for something over the free operand to be an algebra over the DG free, over the time transfer, so with the DG. That's the same equation. So if you start with a modular operand, see this is where the DG comes in, you get the, so sometimes this is called the quantum master equation, so you get this R Kapon piece, but you also get this operator delta. And that comes from self-gluing. So that just comes from little loop. Proper ad, you can get R3 mean, proper ad, you get R3 mean plus a delta, if you take a real prop, you get a DGDD algebra, and so you can go down the list. This is again just now totally general, you can go through, do the Simon transform, ask what the equations you write it out. And these terms correspond to the graph you allow, say, if you're doing graphs. Okay, so if you see a bracket, so if you see a 3D, so this is an ordered way of doing things, it means that you allow exactly graphs of this type where you have roots, and exactly this type of thing that will give you 3D. If I don't have roots, then I can't tell the difference between this way and this way, I just get D. If I have, and the delta comes from brackets, from things that I do self-doing. So that's sort of in the prequel paper. That's actually so fun. Alright, so what do we have to do with geometry? And that is why I get interested in the first place. It's not that I was born a category theorist, it just happens to be that this is the right language to get this. So what a typical example for modular operands. What is it? So if you take the linear number of compactified spaces, so this is a modular operand in spaces, NGN bar. You can just take curves and stick them together if you get them double points. That's it. You have N marked points. And what can I do? I take a curve with n mark points and with n mark points, I stick it together at some curve point, I get n plus n minus 2 mark points. That's exactly against the tree. Or I can take two functions and take another point like that, that's the other operation. Then I can go through the homology, so this is also now easy because, you know, one of the functions from these graphs to topological spaces, and I have a function homology going from topological spaces to